AI is just a prediction, right? There's no ghost behind the machine. It's just a formula of prediction. The results they give, we have to decide, it's for the human to decide whether that answer is ethical, if it really represents society, if it represents the culture and the values of the company. And this discernment and this decision-making can be done only by humans, right? They take the decision procedure. Empathy is one of the main skills that they cannot learn, and discernment as well. Whether it's in AI, in research, in science, we have many, many more women scientists coming to the place. So this is a great thing. In tech, however, especially in mostly in the software and the hard tech, women are still very much underrepresented, including in AI. When you are looking at an environment that is going to be welcoming for women, you can feel it right away. And this you can see by the rate of the dropout of the women going out of the field. It's much higher than the men leaving the field. Also, if it comes to an age where women, maybe they want to found families, structure within the company is going to be something that's going to push them to come back into the workforce. Thank you. they have to look at their team, look at them around. What, you know, is it gender equal? Are there women? Are there men? And even if there are, what are they bringing to the table? Sometimes women, maybe they don't belong or they're not being heard. Ask them questions. Make sure that when you are in a meeting, you have everyone's views are being seen, whether you're a woman or a man. But try and get the views from everybody. And if they don't dare to say, ask questions and make sure they're there. I think visibility is something so important. They have to be able to open up, you know, their voice, be seen, be heard, and make sure that the doors are also opened.
The reason we're building data centers in space is mainly for the energy that we can draw from solar energy in space. So there's almost unlimited access to abundant solar energy in space. The problem on Earth is we're very quickly running out of space and actually energy on Earth to build large data centers. In space, we can have these enormous solar panels, which can power these data centers. And then another advantage is we can then run large radiators to dissipate that heat in infrared out into the vacuum of space, rather than having to boil off huge amounts of fresh water, which is how terrestrial data centers keep cool. The way that we'll launch this data center is by launching individual modules. Each one is about the size of 5 shipping containers. Each one has about 100 tons of compute chips and solar panels and radiators. And then we hook them together in this huge lattice in space in order to make a much larger structure. And in fact, for that 5 gigawatt data center, you're looking at a 4 kilometer by 4 kilometer solar panel with about a 1 kilometer by 4 kilometer radiator. So pretty huge structures in space that we're building. The main cost of the environment will be on the launch, but then we save 10 times the amount over the life of the data center in terms of CO2 output, including the launch, than we would if we had just run that whole data center terrestrially with burning fossil fuels. You don't necessarily want to cover 10 square kilometers of countryside or forest with solar panels. Whereas in space, we don't have these constraints. One of the main reasons why you might want to do quantum computing in general in space is the vacuum of space and the cold of space is ideal conditions for running quantum compute. So rather than having to maintain quite expensive vacuum and extremely cold temperatures artificially terrestrially, you naturally have that occurring in space. My expectation is that within 10 years, almost all new data centers will be being built in space, purely because of the constraint that we're facing on energy terrestrially.